you receive, but always want more. Take it for granted, this lifetime and what's up ahead. But the day is coming, the day is near, the day is coming.
Do you remember the first time you met Dominic?
I don't remember the first time I met Dominic. I don't.
I remember. It was the first time I came over to the Agius house. I was 15. This was like 10 years ago. And Dominic was 13, and he was just learning to play the guitar, and it was the cutest thing ever. He could only play It Smells Like Teen Spirit, and he would just play it over and over again, like, really not very well, but it was, like, the cutest thing in the world. And, you know, he had his huge mouthful of braces, like, crazy wiry hair, just, like, big, goofy smile.
Yeah.
It was kind of weird, because he was, like, a lot younger than me. But he was, I definitely felt him to be a kindred spirit in his, just sort of the way he saw things and how he interacted with people and his sense of humor. We definitely had similar senses of humor.
Dominic and I did actually not get along at all for a while. I mean, he was kind of an asshole to me, frankly. I would try, like, you know, really hard to, like, you know, become friends with him, and he was always just like a kind of a, he's quick with the insult, quicker than I ever was or am.
Since we had all been friends for so long, that should have been just a classic, like, oh, this is my older brother's best friend, and, like, you know, like, at some level, like, an older brother myself, it should have been, like, him looking up to me all the time. And I like to deceive myself sometimes and think, like, oh, yeah, he looked up to me and this and this. But really, it was always just more of a competition with me sort of trying to catch up.
It was just, yeah, one of those places I felt like a safe place. Like, we'd mm-hmm. always come here after after school mm-hmm. or mm-hmm. on the weekends, and just, like, it'd always be, like, a safe place. Like, no, I don't know, just everything was, like, pure here. Like, fun, like, video games,
yeah.
filming, pool parties, hot tub, like, but not,
yeah,
not, like, hot tub, you know, just innocent high right. school kids, like, just, like, hanging out and being silly and...
Yeah.
I think he was kind of, like, the instigator a lot of the time of, like... Jim was kind of, like, the big-time, like, ringleader, but, like, Dominic would come up with, like, the more mischievous, like, ideas that would actually get people into trouble, especially himself.
Definitely.
Or, like, definitely more mischievous, like, the prank calling.
I think it's something to do, forgive me if I'm wrong, but with Chuck Mackey, isn't it?
we used to prank call on a regular basis Chuck Mackey, who is Thomas Mackey's father. All that's behind us now, but at the time it was very humorous to us. We would call him at like 2 in the morning and just go on the phones, go, Chuck! Just really intense guttural, like, I'm going to kill you. Like,
so the police come here, and Dominic, the lawman comes down on Dominic hard. Oh yeah, the lawman comes down hard.
He's like, you call anyone else that night? He's like, I don't know. And the cop's like, did you call someone named Haley Boyan? And Dominic's like, I might have. He's like, do you remember what you might have said to her? And he's like, no. And he like takes his little notepad out and like flips around in it. And he's like, you said, quote, I'm going to cut your tits off. And Maureen's just like, oh, Jesus.
It sounds bad when you say it, but the absence of fear, I think, was one of the most impressive things about him, too. He just had really no care for the consequences. And, you know, why should he? The things you were doing were, in the end, like, who cares? Just a small consequence if somebody gets mad at him for a long time. But those, you know, that fear of consequences is really what rules most of us.
It was his delivery, you know? He'd say it like a good example of the Who's to Say What God Wants song. He brought that to school, to Carl Newman High School. the morning I walk in the music room, he's playing it for everyone. There are these like 50-60-year-old teachers. They're all like into it.
Listening to this song about a pedophile priest.
It's going, 6-year-olds at the jamboree. You know,
who's to say you can't suck off a 6-year-old?
Yeah,
at the jamboree. No, jamboree. It's who's to say you can't fillet a 60-year-old man at the jamboree?
You know, well, there's multiple verses. But,
We just say like, the worst things to people. I remember we were driving and we were like, passed by like an old like woman, like we're like burning a crucifix at the window of the car. We're like, I'll fucking kill you. And just like,
well, like, I think there was something really endearing about his delivery of things like that. I mean, like, yeah, he could say something that most people would find, like, if most people were to say it, would be considered horribly offensive or upsetting or disturbing. But there was something about his delivery of things that people, I mean, it would,
he's, he had,
would just sort of take it and think it was great, you know, like, I don't really know how to describe it. He was very charismatic in that way.
Well, he never had any remorse on anything. In fact, there was a DOD song, which was a band that Dominic and Mike were in, and there was a song, Dr. Satan impales you, mm-hmm. rams a fist in your ass. No remorse, of course. The only thing you feel in your rectum
is force.
Is force.
That's right. Talks about killing a granny, too.
Nothing was, like, really off limits for, like, joking about within the group, but it was all very, like, rude, like, you know, scatological, like, weird sex humor, or just, like, inappropriate, you know, just bizarre stuff. But really, in a way, like, fun, like, kids doing it, you know? Not, seriously weird in any way, just, like, so strange.
Anything with Dominic dancing was fantastic. I remember, I don't know, the Legend of Dirk dance scene,
when he's in his underwear.
In his boxers. So Don't Stop Me Now.
Oh my god, and he has that one move where he's like doing super fast robot arms while he jumps sideways.
Yeah, I love that.
That one is really good.
Yeah, that's probably my favorite.
That's very good. He's definitely a good dancer. He definitely, I think, was in every single dance extravaganza.
Didn't he like invent dance extravaganza?
I think he did. I think
him and Jesse doing their new project of them just dancing around in Dominic's room.
That is a wonderful video.
That video of you two, it is the most fun video. You can be the most cynical person in the world and you can watch that video and it's so fucking fun looking.
I love that video because it really, like, sums up a lot of the, like, spirit of the time. It was just, like, being silly just for no reason.
Yeah.
Oh, I love that video so much.
Well,
I have such fondness for that.
The reason I love that video too, in retrospect, is that's how all my memories have taken shape too, of like all the fun stuff we're talking about now, all the laughter and everything. It can be captured very well in that video and how he's acting and his just over the top. But we've painted a picture of, you know, the hilarious pranks he did, which are like at some level mean spirited, but really they weren't that mean spirited. I think they were to make everybody laugh, and, you know, being controversial is fun and lightens everybody's mood. But it was just fun.
You know, you grow up, things change, and people don't get it anymore. People don't get when you try and talk about the Agius house. People don't get when you try and talk about a very specific person and what makes them, like, amazing, right?
Yeah. I mean, it just felt, we felt like we were related. I mean, pretty much, like, lived here for a while, so, you know. And it's not something you can replace.
I mean, I basically spent the previous, you know, 4 or 5 years as a more or less permanent fixture in this household.
This was just like an everyday thing when you would stay over. And you were over a lot. I mean, gosh, you probably
half the year, probably.
Probably spent half the year here.
It's really interesting, like, how the dynamic of the group was back then. And it seems like kind of beyond like a normal, like, normal group of friends or whatever, that we all had such an impact on each other's lives, and that, you know, we would all be over here for, you know, we'd spend like weeks at a time here, you know, like not going home, just like spending the night here all the time, like as a big group. So that's definitely like atypical, and also I think made us all a lot closer.
So after all that, after I got my driver's license, after all that, I think when we kind of really became, like, if not best friends, like really close to it, that's when we started. I mean, I had gotten much more into music, and Dominic and I would play music together a lot, though I never was like officially in a band or anything with him, though many times I told him I was interested in doing that, but he always would shoot that idea down.
This is a good story how Mute Vernacular forms. So, I mean, Dominic and I had played a lot of music, just sort of messing around, just, you know, we had guitars and drums, and we'd switch off, and we'd sort of write these little instrumental songs, but they were all sort of, like I said, we didn't really know what we were doing. And so then one day, like, I'm walking down this hallway, and Dominic and Riley are in Dominic's room, and Riley's on the drums, and Dominic's on the guitar, and they're playing what eventually became Hideous Grace. And they were just looping through. They were just playing the chorus part over again. Just the fire, and that whole part. And they were just going back and forth, singing that one line back and forth. And I was just like, huh, that sounds kind of cool. So I opened the door and I walked in, and I sort of watched them for like a couple minutes. And there was a bass sitting there. And I was just like, huh. So I picked up the bass. I'd never played the bass or anything, you know, but I mean, I played the guitar, so I figured I could figure it out. So I just picked up the bass and started playing along, and I think by the end of the night, we more or less had Hideous Grace. We were like, okay.
Like, I remember I noticed when he got, like, more serious about music, and, like, it went from the Disciples of Darkness, like, this is fun, we're joking around, like, this is silly, to, like, I'm gonna be a serious musician, like, I'm really, like, legit, like, I'm writing songs, like, these are not funny songs, like, these are cool songs, these are, like, real songs.
And it was just one day, like, well, no, I'm just gonna spend 7 hours a day doing this. I think there are a lot of people, including me in the world, who would like to be able to do that, too. Just decide, like, you know, this is something I've always been interested in, this is what I do now.
I think that's where he really sort of began to see the music as a way for him to forge his own identity separate from being Jim's younger brother, you know? It was like the whole sort of like that little social milieu sort of revolved around making the movies and stuff. And that was very much like you were at the wheel of that operation. And I think he really wanted to have his own projects that he was doing in and of himself.
So I definitely did notice, like, him changing during that time, and I was also not really, like, in the group as much during that time, but, yeah, like, a lot of the, like, mischievous type stuff kind of ended, and he just was doing more so music stuff, which, you know, that's good and bad, but, like, he was growing up, but so was everyone.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's where the music came in, and that's where he really forged his own identity, you know?
In DOD, his original band was more of a, you know, a joke to an extent. I mean, they took it seriously, you know, at times, but, you know, the overall feel, you know, I mean, you look at the song lyrics, you know, it does have humor to it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's, the Mute Vernacular is more so, you know, like, trying to, like, actually say something emotionally.
it's different when you make friends when you're older. You know, when you're a kid, you're at school and friends just come, and you know, a lot of people have anxiety about making friends. But you know, me and Dominic really hit it off, and a lot of our friendship, most of our friendship revolved around music and being in bands, and Epiphany was the place where we were doing that at the time, and we had a lot of late nights over there playing music and getting crazy. Dan Coxon, super loco.
Yeah, so I guess in high school we met, and I remember officially, like, I remember the good first hangout time was, right, a Pack of Wolves first show at, what's that place, Epiphany Music. It used to be Epiphany, and the Mute Vernacular was playing, and it was my band's first show, Pack of Wolves, as just Chesco and I.
At that point, I still wasn't really into it, and then we played a show at Epiphany, and up until that point, I was just really kind of like, yeah, whatever, I'll do this, you know, whatever. We played a show at Epiphany, and like a whole bunch of people showed up, and they all seemed to like really, really enjoy it, be really into it, and at that point, I was kind of like, huh. Well, okay, we're a band now. Like, let's take this and run with it.
I met Dom when Alexis did, I guess, originally back in the day, when Girls in Suede played with Mute Vernacular, the Phoenix. I met him very casually, and I'd always run into Dominic very quickly because I moved to San Francisco at the time, and he was still in high school, which at that age, I feel like makes a world of difference. So he stayed really good friends with my close friends, you know, but there's a weird schism, like Girls in Suede ended right then and Dom and Eden stayed good friends. And I kind of fell like into San Francisco cracks of whatever.
It was funny because we hung out with each other more, even though I didn't go to school with him, and our interests just seemed to, I mean, that's, we got really into like Modest Mouse and like, a lot of the local bands like Girls in Suede. Like I still have their old CD that they did back then.
Like when I was going to Newman, it was, you know, it felt like you guys were like celebrities.
Seriously. Well, you know, we were.
No, it was like, you know, I'd see like the album sitting in like teachers' classrooms and stuff, you know, like every, you know, it was like, just the point is, you know, it was all around the school.
That's weird for me because I have no, like, yeah. I have no context of,
no, it was,
of that sort of thing.
It was, right? Everywhere.
I can't think of a lot of specific instances of that time because most of it was like this repetitive, we would be, you know, getting high and like playing music and going to a show, or that's pretty much all we were doing. I don't really remember any like monumental things that occurred then.
The first Mute Vernacular show at the Phoenix in the fall of 2005, I guess it was. And I remember having to like reassure Riley and Dominic that even though I was going to go smoke some pot before we got on stage, that like, I'll be okay, you know, I'll yeah. still be able to play and yeah. everything, you know, which is interesting in hindsight. I wonder if Dominic yeah. was running off to his car to do what I was doing, running off to my car to do, you know. I don't know it, like really timing wise.
It was very much so like at 2004 era, it was if you know, you're on drugs or planning to do them and Dominic found out about it, he would almost be angry at you.
Yeah,
you know, it definitely awkward, you know, like it was a very, very serious stance, you know. He had his mind made up at that point.
Dominic actually pursued a friendship with me, I would have to say. You know, he like called me up and wanted to hang out, and I remember being like, man, this guy's like a really wily, energetic guy. Like I honestly didn't think I could keep up with him at that time. Like I was all down and he was so excitable.
A lot of it was just good old-fashioned fun for a long time, and that's how I just got to know him. And he was a goofball, super excitable, and I was really excitable too.
When I came back from LA, and I pretty much told Dominic, you know, my whole story about moving down there and getting involved in pretty serious drugs and how things sort of spiraled out of control, and you know, how I was able to undo a lot of hard work in terms of trying to get a band off the ground and whatnot. And I was always a little uneasy about those conversations because I was concerned that he wasn't paying enough attention to how the story ended. You know, I mean, like, because it's, you know, the first 6 months of it, it's like, yeah, I'm down in LA playing in a band and it's parties and whatever, blah, blah, blah. It wasn't really parties. It was just sort of a, you know, an apartment full of people doing all sorts of crap, you know? And But I mean, I remember like trying to like, you know, consciously trying to convey to him the idea that like, look, man, it's not, we weren't Led Zeppelin having a great time. I mean, it was like there was a band and there was the apartment full of drug addicts, and the amount of time, I mean, at first it was lots of time spent on music and a little bit of time spent on drugs, but it's like things quickly spiral out of control where it's like the band just became a non-issue, and now it's just, well, we're just doing drugs all the time. You know, and that how easy it is to get sucked into that black hole once you start staring over the edge, you know?
And I was so stoned and we were just being so silly, and I was with Dom and he's like, hey, like, my family owns Petaluma Market, and I didn't know that at the time. And I'm like, really? That's awesome. And he's like, yeah, do you want to go in there and get some snacks? And then I was like, you know, the wheels were turning. I'm like, whoa, like, you mean like anything? And he's like, yeah, man, get whatever you want.
He just always seemed like almost like over secure at that point to me. Like it was like he, you know, like
untouchable.
Well, it was like, you know, you meet someone and you're kind of like, you know, does this person have their shit together, like more or less than I do, sort of, you know? It's like, it was someone who was very much so like, this person like knows what they're doing.
So I went in there and I like parted ways with him and whoever we were with. And I like, sorry, Aegis family, but I kind of went to town, you know, like I think I got a thing of liver pate, like yogurt pretzels, like some sparkling pink, like grapefruit, and like a thing of sushi. And I knew that I'd like way overdone it because like I came back and rejoined with the group and everyone else in the group had like a bag of chips and like a thing of soda. And I was like, oh, fuck. Like, but anyways, Dom let me, like, thank you, Dom. Like, that was honestly one of my life goals, was to go into a grocery store and eat whatever I wanted.
Completed.
He was always taking it to the limit with alcohol and drugs and stuff, experimenting. And, you know, I knew he was a wild kid, and I was a pretty wild kid in high school too.
During that period, I mean, by that time it was like, I came back, I would come back on the weekends and stuff. And I think, neither Dominic or I were in a very good place.
I had gotten into a lot like harder drugs when I started going to Santa Rosa. I mean, I tried like crystal meth. I was doing cocaine on occasion. I was like, we were all into this band scene. You know, I was never in like a good band or anything.
That was when I really started that, you know, he's kind of pushing the envelope here, you know, like, he was having a lot of conflicts with your mom. And I mean, for me, it was like, I would show up, you know, every couple of weeks I'd show up for the weekend, I'd be around for a couple of days and I'd take off. So I would just sort of get these snapshots of his weekend life. And, you know, all his buddies would always be over here, and it would be, it got to the point where it was, like, difficult for us even, like, have practice, because he wanted to sort of hang out with his friends or whatever, you know? And, you know, Riley just wasn't really having it. And I specifically remember Riley was gave me a ride up to my folks' place, and we were cruising out Reebley Road, and he was, like, really quiet, and then he just sort of, like, so I think this show is going to be my last show with me vernacular. And I was like, okay, you know, if you don't want to do it, you don't want to do it. You know, that's, can't make you do it. And at that point, I'd really gotten sort of fed up with dealing with Riley as well.
It seemed like normal, I guess. And it didn't seem in excess at that time. I mean, you know, we messed around with things and, you know, did our fair share of like experimenting, but then I left. I went to a school in Massachusetts for the summer. And, I mean, that's kind of when I stopped doing all that stuff.
It was supposed to be a comeback show. It turned into a farewell show.
Was that the farewell for Riley with, who played with you?
Advantage.
You know, I came over after a show that we'd all played, and everyone had taken acid. And I wasn't expecting that. And everyone got really wild. And everyone was pretty wild, and I could tell Dominic was kind of scared.
I don't want to say random, but just lots of people coming over.
Yeah, it was. I remember like coming back over after the show,
and
it was like,
and with the explicit purpose of partying. You know, it wasn't. It wasn't even social.
Yeah, it was Bacchanalia.
And I was having a hard time keeping everybody together, and it was getting kind of negative.
I remember people commenting about how much drugs everyone was, like, people were like, you guys are like amazing.
Simon House. Simon House was like, dude, this is really weird. What's going on here?
It was a big, like, for me and Dominic, it was a pretty big jump, you know?
And I shut the door, it was pitch black, and I could hear muffled sounds of people getting wild and stuff in the living room. And I fall asleep for, you know, maybe, it's hard to tell when you're asleep, but maybe, you know, half an hour. And then the door opened slowly, which isn't like Dominic, obviously. And the door cracked open slowly, and he asked if he could go in there with me. And I felt sad because I knew, you know, because he wasn't asking as a silly thing. He was asking because he was scared.
It felt very invaded.
Well, it wasn't about, like, getting back to, like, do drugs or anything. It was about getting back to be in the sanctuary. To, like, hot tub and, like, you know, socialize. It was, you know, that really changed after that era. It became much more so, let's get back to do the drugs.
Yeah, people were just, like, hanging out and smoking in the house.
And it became, you know, all these acquaintances that were just drug acquaintances, you know, nothing more, you know. And, you know, before then, they wouldn't be anywhere near the house. Like, one of the first times I actually felt, like, uncomfortable here.
As, like, an acoustic songwriter, though, you know, I've never heard anybody that could write lyrics like him. It was weird, you know. It's funny, just, like, having, like, a sit-down, like, play a song back and forth and everything, and just, like, listening to the words and being like, oh, shit. That's pretty crazy.
We really found, like, our own sort of unique approach and sound and stuff.
It always made you feel so comfortable. You
know? Yeah.
Like, when I started playing keyboard, I didn't know what the hell I was doing. You know, and we played, you know, that Heart and Soul song, you know, the cliche, for probably, like, 3 hours, you know. And I, you know, that's what made me become a pianist. You know, it was like that someone, you know, like, showing me, hey, you can do this, you know.
Yeah.
As far as, like, beautiful lyrics, you know, he just has his lyrics, like the song Sleepless that I covered, like, one day, hopefully, when we pass, we'll turn into grains, and those grains of sand will be church glass so we can hang with color and class. And I know Alexis and I, like, looked at each other at his funeral, because that letter he wrote to Leslie Ann was so articulate and so beautifully scripted that I remember Alexis and I looked at each other, we were like, whoa, was Dom a secret, like, genius?
Best quote from Thomas Mackey. I never really even listened to music.
Well, I didn't. I was missing out.
No shit. I remember I was floored when you told me that. I was like, are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah. No, but, you know, like, I felt like I, you know, I had no idea what I was doing on the instrument. You know, and Dominic sort of, you know, it's like I'd see him, you know, doing things. It's like he clearly knows something that I don't, you know. And he made it feel like it, you know, it was okay that, you know, he was on this whole other level than I was, but he'd still play with me, you know. Mm-hmm. It's like I even find myself, you know, nowadays when I'm playing with someone far lower, it's just harder to, you know. He had this certain like warmth about him, you know, that really brought out artistic value in mm-hmm. people, you know. It was, you know, it changed my life completely.
I have always been a fan of his songwriting and his guitar playing, you know, like he did what a lot of people don't do, which is choosing to educate himself on music and his instrument. And he had, in my opinion, a really excellent songwriting skill, which was, you know, he knew a lot of really complex stuff, but he played really basic seeming stuff, you know. He made his complex, you know, intuition sound effortless.
To this day, I think he was just a great lyric writer. I mean, he was able to spin words together in ways that I could never match. You know, I would contribute a few lines here, a few lines there. I think, you know, mostly I would contribute musical stuff and, like, arrangement stuff. But his ability to throw a hook together and make a catchy little chorus and stuff, like, I mean, it was just really good at it.
He didn't have to wank off and show off everything he knew in one measure of music, you know what I mean? Just his chord changes, you know, speak for themselves. Like, they're really unique. Like, I listen to a lot of my friends' music, and his music is way more unique than anything else.
Fantastic Lovers really started out more as a name of a band, where it was like, you know, Riley had sort of left the scene, and we were all sort of around.
It was
and...
also like an idea for a band.
Yeah.
You know, it was like the way it got described to me was, you know, everyone's going to have a headset on. There's going to be a pyrotechnic light show at every show. And we're going to do dance moves. That's what he
told me. Did I say that?
No, Dominic did.
Okay.
That sounds formed pretty spontaneously as well. Yeah. It was just kind of like throwing together every member of a band who wasn't currently in a band at the time.
Definitely.
Meanwhile, I'm coming back here trying to like maintain this band, and like I very much felt like I was like the sort of like the logistical sort of band leader guy who would organize practices and would run the practice and figure out, you know, how we were going to do this, and I was in no condition to be at all effective at that. Meanwhile, Dominic was doing a lot of cocaine, and his behavior was getting more and more erratic, and that's when he and I really started to butt heads over like musical direction.
I think the hardest part about getting Dominic to start a band and everything was waiting for the decline of the Fantastic Lovers, which I was kind of, I like the band. They're a killer band.
Yeah.
But I was like, damn, I want to be in a band with Dominic. We could be the next Beatles. You know?
So we're all really dissatisfied with, we're just really dissatisfied with everything. I mean, I know I was really dissatisfied with my personal life at the time. I was really dissatisfied with the music. I was really dissatisfied that my relationship with Dominic was breaking down. And, you know, it really all came to a head. I think it got to a point where it was like, well, the way I really see it is that with the cocaine use, I think that like we got to the point where you and I could really, really see where this was headed. Yeah. That in terms of just like the drug use, that it was like really getting out of control.
Yeah, eventually it just kind of like, oh, I haven't heard about a Fantastic Lovers show in a while. Dominic, what are you doing? He's like, oh yeah. It's like we could both sing and it'll be sick and we'll fucking go on tour. And we did.
It very much reminds me of my experience down in LA, where it's like you put in all this time and energy into a project, and it's almost sort of like just sort of a classic tragedy, where it's like the moral failings of the players or the people involved undo all the work. And it's like and the way I see it in my mind is it was very much a band that was undermined by cocaine. Like that is like really how I see it.
Wrote five songs and like,
wrote five songs in like a week. Yeah, in an hour. And then pretty much like recorded them, went straight to the Phoenix, played a show.
You know, I mean, I've said this to you. I've said this to Mackie. I feel like, you know, like you and I could see the writing on the wall, and we did what we had to do to take care of ourselves and got ourselves out of the trap, but we left the man behind. And I think Dominic never, I mean, I think, I don't know that it's a total straight line from that time to his death, but it's a pretty clear trajectory, at least in my head.
Yeah, and then the next thing I heard that he was going to rehab. And yeah, that was the next thing I heard about him.
He was really attracted to that like dangerous Lou Reed musician type, where you're this chariot on fire, like constantly in a state of about to go out in a blaze, but still carrying on.
He got out and he was clean, I remember, and which, to me at the time, I remember sounding horrible. I remember it sounding just like the worst thing ever. Like thinking to myself, oh my God, if I could never drink again, if I could never do drugs again, if I could, like, that sounds fucking horrible. And that was a long time ago. But yeah, so 2007. So he moved in, November. We all moved in together, and it was a disaster right off the bat. I like to cook at home. Dominic never cooked, and he stayed up late, and I thought the rehab would have him, you know, calm a lot, you know, going to meetings and having his time preoccupied and not really spending a lot of late nights with friends and stuff. I thought that would be a temptation for him and stuff, and ultimately it did prove to be that, but, you know, and so we had a rough start. And And I got angry a lot and got resentful. I didn't always handle things the best way.
There were a couple moments where we'd play a song and people seemed like very happy about it until they heard the lyrics, you know. Fet Sounds was kind of offensive as a band, and it was more on like a personal level than like a
sort of
broadcast thing.
Yeah, so I would nitpick him, and I would say, like, you gotta lock the door, you gotta do your dishes, you gotta be quiet, you gotta, like, get the old food out of your room, you gotta, like, you know, it was every day, it was something, and he would get angrier and angrier every day, and I got super angry, and I was thinking, this guy's fucking gone. If he does one more thing that pisses me off, I'm fucking kicking him out, and I'll just get a random-ass roommate off Craigslist, I don't give a fuck, and, like, I mean, we got fucking angry at each other, which was shitty, in a lot of ways, because Dominic and I were such good friends before we lived together. And I thought that, you know, as naive as I was, I thought living together would be, oh, we're just going to become brothers, you know? I guess in a sense we did, you know? But I just thought, how, you know, of course dealing with problems with your friends is easier than dealing with strangers, but it's like...
Dominic never not wanted to play a show. Like, we knew that we'd be playing in some, like, dungeon basement shithole nowhere, and Dominic would be down to play it. So,
or in like a Chippendale strip club, they still played it.
And I wrote him this letter. It was, must have been 3 or 4 pages long, and I said, and I laid everything out to him, and I tried to be like, and I tried to take responsibility for some of the problems that we were having, and I tried to just write this letter in love, and just like, and not write it in like scribbling anger and like. I try to just be, you know, separate myself and just write it in a really good way.
One time I was talking with him about a show that he was playing with, like, just a really bad band, and I was like, you should play, like, with better lineups, like, you know, get on to bills with that, and he was like, no, dude, I'm down to play any show at all, and he was like, I may not like their music, but I'm glad that that band exists. He was really just appreciative of just like the scene in general.
Totally, man.
And so he supported every single band, even if they fucking sucked. And a lot of them sucked.
You know, I thought he'd be so fucking pissed, and like I sat down with him, and he's like, and the first thing he said, he's like, hey, I really want you to know like how much I love you. And like right then I was like, I love you a lot too. I love you a lot, Dominic. And I'm sorry if that letter hurt your feelings. And he's like, no. Like, you know, this was like a really nice letter. And I agree with everything in it. And I'm sorry. And I don't want to move out. Like, I want to work it out and stuff. And it was such a nice thing. It was such a nice thing for him to do, because he had options, but he was really like interested in like, you know, like being and like owning up to it. And things got a lot better after that in the house.
I obviously get along with someone I want to make music with. Definitely like a connection that I made within that.
For sure.
Scene when I was really trying to develop myself within it and trying to like figure out my role in it. Someone that I connected to right away, but always was just like slightly intimidated by his level of talent and how much it exceeded my own. But
oh yeah, how prolific he was.
Just how talented he was yeah, in general.
Yeah, well, no, I mean like he could crank out like, you know, next time you'd see him, he'd have like 3 or 4 new songs, and 2 of them would be solid gold, and the other 2 he would kind of like shelf for later maybe.
The super awesome thing about Dominic, he like wrote a new song every day. Like, we'd always have new songs.
I know there was a lot of times where he felt bad about his ability, but I have always been amazed at his ability to crank out songs, and not just in quantity, but also in quality. Like, I have never known anyone to spit out not just writing songs, but recording them faster than Dominic.
I could talk for so long about, you know, how good he was at writing songs, but one thing I've always admired is just how much he wrote. Yeah. Because you don't get good by waiting to get better. You get good by just hashing it out.
Yeah. And, you know, oh, absolutely. And he told me your face until he it told gets me good that and... he told me once he I remember him telling me explicitly that he wants to be as prolific as possible for as long as he can
just so that he'll be able to just amass a body of work before he realizes it. And that's exactly what he did.
Mission accomplished.
Yeah, dude. He cranked it out.
He'd like open his guitar case and whole lyrics would fall out. But yeah, and it was just, and the way that he would write the lyrics too, because he would have like 5 minute songs where he was just singing the whole time. Yeah. You know, and it would be just like flowing, honest, poetical, lyrical shit.
I definitely don't think I would, you know, I don't have the volume. He has volumes of music. You know, I don't know anyone that young with volumes of music. We all write a bunch of songs, but volumes of music.
Dominic would burn all the CDs. Like, he would record all our stuff besides our last CD that Robert recorded. Like, Dominic and I pretty much were like a team. Like, we'd make everything. Like, we wanted to be this total DIY band. Like, he would record us and it would sound really good. Like, why do we have to pay someone else to record us? My life inside the Kaleidoscope. So that was the first CD. The second one was Poison Apples. So I decided to have, like, you know, to have all the lyrics inside and our information, and then like in the back four pages I have like a little story of this little monster eating an apple, and then it was poisoned and then he died. But in a cute, happy way.
I remember when I first heard when he and Sarah first started, they were like, hey, here's a music video of our new single set with clips to 10 Things I Hate About You. And I heard it and I was just like, yeah, this is the best song that Dom has ever written. And then I felt like he kept outdoing himself. First time I heard Bittersweet, I was like, fucking A, man, this is the best song that Dom ever wrote, for sure. And then after, yeah, he just kept doing it.
You know, like, easily we could have just burned CDs and handed them out, but we're like, no, we're gonna like tell people, like, we care about this band, like, you know, like, we put a lot of love in it. I hope you love us back, you know.
When you go on tour with a band, it's fun, it's great to get out of town, to cut loose, whatever, and it's all the better to do it with, you know, friends of yours. But doing it with Pet Sounds and with Dominic and Corey and Tony and Steve, who was in it at the time, you know, they were just, before any of us were in those lineups of bands, we were friends first, you know? So to be out on the road and young with each other, that was pretty much as good as it got, you know what I mean? And I remember, you know, Dominic just itching to tour, to hit the road and just, you know, play out of town.
I remember when we were on tour, he, you know, like, on our day off or during the day, he was like, you know, I'm in a new place. Like, I want to be inspired. Like, when I get back from this tour, I want to have written 3 songs.
I think one of the reasons Dom played in bands, I think you can never deny the music side of it for anyone who's in bands. But, you know, some people play in bands just for the music. And then after they have band practice, there's people like that, you know, they go home, they like are hired bass players, hired guitar players, and they do what they have to do and play what they have to play. But Dom's definitely of the school that Alexis and myself and Eden are in, where you're in a band because you want camaraderie. And, you know, I think that's why like Dom loved in all of his bands, you know, it was just the, just hanging out and having pracky, you know, like, mm-hmm. which he would call it, just having pracky and just,
yeah.
just kicking it and like driving. Just the small stuff, you know, like Dom, that's why it's so good to be in a band with Dom, because you didn't have to explain it. You just know it when there's someone like that. But like the music's one thing, but like Dom was right there with you. That one of the best thing about being in the band is all the small stuff, you know, like watching TV together and like driving on the freeway together and like.
And singing parts in the car together.
Yeah, singing, you know, yeah, the brotherhood of it, you know, and Dom was like.
He was instantly part of that.
Yeah.
I think we're thinking about the same thing.
What are we thinking about? I don't know what you're thinking about.
throughout my entire life, the only thing that I've ever done, like, ever consumed is weed and alcohol. Except for one time. There was one time in my life where I tried something else. and it was with Dom. It was at Nickel City, totally, in San Jose. We went down there to see the Velveteen. It was like their first show back.
As a four-piece. Yeah, it was like their first show in a year and a half, and they were playing.
And everybody was super excited.
Yeah, everyone was there.
So we went to that Velveteen show, and Dominic drove, and I remember being super excited, and everything was good, actually. And I was hanging out with this girl, Kat, and she was cool, and I was feeling pretty good about life. And so we showed up to the show, and that was what was weird, is that Dominic, that was the first time.
But it was basically you, me, Dom, and Eden just hanging out for the bulk of that show. Because there was like 10 bands on the bill, and they were all acoustic until the Velveteen, where they come in and just tore it up. It was dope. So we were just hanging out.
I was so excited that night to like see the band and stuff. But I had like a massive headache. I had been drinking a little bit and wanting to like party and everything like that.
What was weird is we all drank a little bit, and I was like having a good time. And then Dominic brought me in the bathroom, and he was like, and he didn't tell me he was doing anything. We just went in the bathroom, and he took out the pill.
Was it like a half?
I think it was a full one.
It was a full...
Maybe it might have even been half.
Yeah, of OxyContin, and we split it between the four of us. And sure enough, he was right. It got rid of my headache.
Okay, and I stood there, and I watched him do it, and I was like... I remember being like, what the fuck? Like, has he been doing this at home? Like, how does he know how to do all this stuff? And being like... whoa. But I wasn't concerned. I was just like, that's weird.
Like, I never have any intentions on you know, ever doing any drugs or anything, but just the one time that I ever tried anything at all was with him.
Yeah.
So I fucking snorted it, and 10 minutes later, it was the best feeling ever. It was just like, it was heaven. And, yeah, and Dominic and I ended up, you know, doing a lot, and I was stoked on it.
That was long before I knew that he had a problem.
And I liked it. I liked the whole ritual. I liked the whole thing of it. And Dominic was snorting it too. And I did it for a little while, on and off, for a couple weeks throughout the summer. And every day it progressed. It was like, I'm only going to do it on the weekend. Okay, I'm only going to do it if I have 3 days off of it. And I was like, okay, I'm only going to do it when my homework's done. All right, I'm only going to do it after 12 o'clock.
He was pretty open with me about it.
Was he?
I was there one of the times that he bought a pill of OC, and I remember being astounded that a single pill was $50.
Whoa.
Yeah.
His self-esteem was pretty... yeah, he'd, like, flip back and forth, you know, like, some shows he'd play and he'd be, like, so bummed. He's like, I did a horrible job, like, this was the worst show ever, like, I hate Santa Rosa, I hate the music scene, you know.
I mean, as trite as it sounds, it made me feel so numb. So okay with everything that was happening around me.
And then it's like, everyone liked us, you know, like, if there wasn't, like, a full crowd of people, he would like take it personally and think, you know, that he just didn't do a good job, or like he'd want people to see him play, you know.
But you know, there's a certain type of person, there really is, that's like that feels that feeling and is like, I mean, it was instant. I knew it the moment it went up my nose. I was like, I mean, I knew it. I knew that this was the drug for me.
If he ever wanted to talk, I would always listen, you know? And we did talk about a lot of, you know, deep stuff. Like, something that I talked to him about really frequently was his music and his attitude towards music and his self-esteem about it. And, you know, I know, being a musician, that there's always a sound in your head, and then there's always the sound that you're making, and they don't always line up, and it's really frustrating sometimes.
But anyways, yeah, so he'd been using for a long time. He and I started using together, and I got back from that tour, and he got me a pill, and then it started getting wild. And he started smoking it. And I got angry because I could smell it all the time in the house. He'd smoke it in his room, and I don't know if you've ever smelled it, but... smells like burning aspirin, if you can imagine it, you know what I mean? Like putting gasoline on aspirin and burning it. And
And I used a lot, but for some reason, I still saw a difference between Dominic and I. I was like, I'm not like that. I knew he was developing a serious problem with it. Because now that it was out in the open, now that we both used, the house fell apart. And it became all about how we're going to get it and who we're going to get it from. And it was hard to get, and it was expensive. And he had been working at Mary's for a while, for half a year or something like that. And then he went to go work with you guys. He went to go work at Petaluma Market.
And I remember I went over to this guy's place to buy some pot. And Dominic showed up. And he was clearly surprised to see me. And he proceeded to buy some methadone from this guy. And that was like when I was really like, what is going on here? I don't know what's going on here, but it's not good.
Yeah, and I was up to maybe half a pill a day by then, 40 milligrams, 60 milligrams. Maybe I'd buy two pills every 3 days. And I didn't really know how much he was using because we stopped using together, because drug addicts don't. They don't really want company after a while because they don't want to share. Which is ugly and gross, I know, to think about.
And I didn't say anything at the time. I kept my mouth shut. I just sort of, watched. I didn't want to sort of tip my hand, I just sort of observed. Shared that information with you. I didn't really know what he was into. I just knew that that was a bad clue. Whatever it indicated, it wasn't anything good.
Something happened. I was going to move out of the house. And I told Dominic that if he wanted to stay, he could. And he was like, okay, I'll stay. And then I decided not to move out a couple days later. And he said, well, you know what? I'm going to move. I need to move out. I can't have my parents pay for this anymore. Or some other weird thing. And I was using pretty heavily, and he was using heavily. And by this time, that guy, that black kid we were getting from Ronnie or something, he got arrested. He was caught for dealing. And so we moved over to Jeff Campbell. And that, I guess, actually, that's where things got fucking heavy. So Dominic introduced me to Jeff. And by that time, everyone, it was out in the open. It was a pretty big thing. He was using it. And it was a pretty... Everybody was high on it. But, some people would just do it when other people had it. They'd buy a pill here or there when they could find it, but didn't, not everybody used it like Dominic and I.
They never, after I was gone, it's like every time, we'd have a great time, I'd come back and see him, but he didn't seem the same anymore. I don't know, it might have been the drugs, it might have been depression, or probably a combination of the both. It might have been the fact that we'd never got to see each other much, and maybe we weren't actually as close as I thought we were.
So I left on tour, I got a new roommate for a little while, this girl Jen, and then she moved out, because she knew I was an addict. She found out I was an addict, and she moved out, and I was using hella heavily, and I thought... In December, I was like, I need to take a break from this stuff. And on tour, I thought, I'm not going to do this. And I left on tour and for a month. And I didn't bring any with me or anything like that. I just left it cold turkey. And that was fucking shitty.
But, it was hard to see sometimes. And, I knew after I'd seen him and he was, like, so skinny. And I was like, I knew something was really, really wrong with that. And it's like, I don't really know what to do about it. I'm like pretty much out of the picture. I live 3,000 miles away, and he tells me he's fine now and clean. It's like, who am I to I always feel like it's almost condescending when you try and like talk to someone about something like that, unless they bring it up to you first, like they seek help, like don't give help if they don't want it.
And I got back from tour at 6 a.m. for being gone for a month and being sober or being clean from OxyContin for that long. I got back at 6 a.m. and I called Jeff. And I was like, Jeff, I need a pill right fucking now. Wake up. I went to his house and I picked up a pill at 6 a.m. I hadn't slept all night. Drove all the way from Oregon or from Utah. drove all the way from Utah and drove all night. And I told Jessica, I just want to get home. But I knew I'd already made the decision the night before. I'm like, I'm going to get fucking high when I get home. And so we showed up. And so I showed up and I got the pill and stuff. And I just picked up right where I left off. And it got fucking heavy as fuck. Within a couple weeks. And the first time I saw Dominic again was January, like 2 weeks after I got back.
So you know, I guess that night that I took that whatever it was quarter of a line with him was the only time I ever saw him do any kind of drugs, now that I think about it. Because yeah, I remember I guess you know, I never thought there was a problem because I never saw it come up again. The next time I had heard about it was when he went into rehab.
I pulled up. Jeff told me to show up, and I pulled up, and I pulled up right behind Dominic's car, and I was like, "Oh, weird." And I didn't even realize that I hadn't talked to him in this long. And I hopped out, and I hopped in the car, and Dominic jumped for a second and looked at me, and I was like, "Hey." And he's like, "Hey." He didn't even acknowledge that we hadn't talked in 3 months, and I was like, "Hey, awesome to see you." He's like, "Yeah, yeah, totally. Oh, yeah, totally." You know, but his mind was elsewhere.
It was weird, you know, because I remember, you know, realizing that he was starting to, like, get into that, and it was a while before it was a long time, probably too late before I even realized where it was going and what it had become.
And I was like, I'm picking up a pill, and he's like, I'm picking up a pill too. And Jeff came out and gave Dominic 4 pills, and gave me 1, and Dominic pulled out fucking $160 or something like that, or $180. And I was like, what the fuck? And I was like, you're really stocking up, aren't you? He's like, yeah, yeah, I'm stocking up. And I was like, okay. And I just went my separate way. And I was like, and I remember leaving, you know, and I always, whenever I picked up a pill, I'd just drive down the street and do a line real quick. And as I was leaving, Dominic didn't even do that. He opened his side compartment and got out the tinfoil. And, you know, and I just left when he was roasting his first pill.
It kind of seems like, you know, the moment that I realized that my friend had a problem was the moment that it was, you know, being dealt with, you know, with him and amongst your family, and like him going to Azure for the first time.
Once I got sober, I looked back, and between June and I didn't even use it almost for a full year, but between June and March when I got clean, I'd spent about $10,000, which is a fucking shit ton of money to go up your nose.
First time I found out he was in rehab, I was hanging out with Chesco at Chesco's house, and he was selling me my electric piano. It's like a
CP30?
Yeah, the CP30, a Yamaha, and I was in town for spring break, and I was like, so yeah, man, what's up? And then, you know, we were chatting for maybe 30, 45 minutes or something like that. And I was like, oh yeah, man, what's up with Dom? I haven't heard from him. I texted him when I got into town, and he was like, dude, Dom's in rehab.
And I kind of forget what happens and after this, because I was pretty heavy. I was up to about 2 pills a day at this point. And this was between January and March. And I heard that he went off the deep end. And I kind of knew he already had, you know. And that he was shooting up.
And I was like, all right, well, you're exaggerating. I know that you are. And he was like, no, dude, it got to the point where he was smoking 3 pills a day and was having to have to like steal money from it. And so he just came clean and acknowledges that he has a problem. And that was after I'd already been on like the drug run with him and knew how the scale worked. And I was like, wow, that's ridiculous. And I ended up talking with him about the experience later on, and he was just like, yeah, man, it was just completely clean now. He was completely clean when I talked to him.
And wow, wasn't that a different Dom too? Because Dom was always.
Go ahead.
Well, I mean, I never knew that it was a problem, but once he was clean and we were recording the Mystery Invention record in early 2010. He was like the most full of life dude ever.
So he wrote a few songs in rehab, and he like, right when he got out, was like, I want band practice. Like, he's like, I have all these ideas. So like, I think the next day we like recorded a video or like recorded a song, learned a song, recorded it that day. And then the next day he's like, let's do a video and band practice. Like he just like wanted to jump on, you know, get back on and like get started.
Cheska told me he was leaving the band. He wasn't leaving the band, he was moving to LA, which essentially means our band was over. I worked hella hard the last 4 years about this band. Dominic went to rehab for the second time. And I was up and I had no more money. You know, I was about to run out of money in a week. I had no more money to pay my rent. I had fucking, like I said, spent almost $10,000 on OxyContin. And I was a fucking straight up addict. Like, you know, I knew what it meant now to be an addict, to sell shit, to be like, where the fuck am I gonna get $45 today?
You could see like how happy he was and like, I know that he was scared being sober because he's like, well, what if I'm boring? Like, you know, like, what if I can't write when I'm sober? You know, like, he was scared of being sober, but at the same time, like, he was so amazing sober. Like, he had so much energy in life.
But he's only been out for either a couple weeks or a couple days, and he wants to see everybody. And so he showed up, and that's what I remember seeing him, being like, he was sober for the first time in his life. Since I've known him, since I ever knew him. And I was fucking super high. And Dominic came up to me and he's like, hey, it's so weird to think about the situation. I thought it would be more emotional, but I guess it's just the way it is. But he came up to me and he said, he was like, hey, if you ever want to stop, just let me know. And you know, we were in my room and I was like, and I pretended like I didn't know what he was talking about at first. I was like, what do you mean? Like, what do you mean? He's like, if you ever want to stop, like if you want this to be done, like you just let me know and I'll take you to a meeting. And I was like, okay. And I sat there with him quietly, and he was quiet. And I was like, all right, pick me up tomorrow, 9:00. And he's like, all right, I'll be here. And he was like, I was like, it was nice seeing you. And he was like, it's nice seeing you too. I'll see you tomorrow. And he left, and I partied all night, and I did the rest of my pill I had, and I got super fucked up. I stayed up all night and then fell asleep at 4:00 in the morning, and at, you know, 8:30, Dominic knocked on the door. And he was like, are you ready to go? And I was in my underpants. I was like, I was fucked up, and I thought for a second, fuck, I'm not going. I'm not gonna fucking do this. And he's like, come on, let's just go. And I was like, okay. And I was like, okay, fine. And I got dressed, and he drove me to a meeting in Coffee Park somewhere. It was a big early meeting, huge meeting, NA meeting, not an AA meeting, big NA meeting. And I, you know, and I saw all these people around me, and I realized for the first time in my life, like, I'm finally one of these people. Like, all these people with their teeth missing, like, all these people itching themselves and, like drinking coffee and like just trying to get through the day sort of thing. Like, I'm here. And like, Dominic was there next to me. And I sat there and I started listening to this guy's story. There's a speaker there, and in the middle of the meeting I got up and I went outside and I cried and about my life and about how shitty things had got. And Dominic came out afterwards, after I'd sat there and I was laying on my back on the cement. And Dominic came out and sat on a bench next to me and didn't say anything. We just sat there, and I laid on the ground, and then the meeting was over. And we got in my car and I had him drop me off at my dad's house. And yeah, I had him drop me off at my dad's house, and I showed up, and my dad asked me what was up and why I was there. And I told my dad that I was an addict. And and that I was an addict. And I laid everything out. And I told him how bad my life had gotten and all that. And then I spent the next 5 days at his house detoxing.
Girls in Suede is a band that was formed by Alexis Lauren Faulkner, Eden Anthony Mazzola, Francesco Joseph Catania, and Nikos Elliott Flaherty Laub. And we played in Santa Rosa for 3 years, from 2003 to New Year's Day 2006, and broke up for 4 years, and did our own things, you know. Actually didn't really make too much communication in those 4 years. It was a pretty like dramatic breakup, you know, because it was just like breaking up with like three people at the same time. Like, you know, and we got back together again in April 2010, and Cesco didn't join the band because he was busy with other things.
Let's jump around a little bit. He took your place in Girls in Suede.
I didn't know about that at first. I think he was scared to tell me, but I didn't care. I had declined the offer, you know, respectfully.
But Alexis and Eden and myself did do the band, and we needed a fourth member. And we were thinking about who we wanted to be. And we knew that for our band, it's so important, like the chemistry. We didn't want to just like find someone who just like shredded on guitar, who wasn't like a silly duck cluck, you know? And and Dom played guitar and lived with Eden, and he was super down. And just to give him a compliment, like he really did his homework, you know. Like, we sat down and tabbed out all of our old guitar lines and Chesco's guitar lines and bass lines that he had to learn, and we sent it to him, and we had our first practice in Oakland, and he showed up really prepared. Like, it was very obvious that he did his homework and took it seriously, and he had his I got to see that side of him. Like, I mean, he was like really on top of the ball, you know. He had his like notebook with the tabs I'd given him with like notes, and he was playing it, not just saying that, he was literally like playing it note for note very well. Like, I could tell he sat down with the CD.
And he still could write, and like, you know, nothing bad was gonna happen from being sober, you know. Like, he just wanted to keep busy, get his mind off things.
And I think for the first like month or a couple weeks, like, Dom was more quiet, you know, trying to find his groove, but he got comfortable real fast.
And his, you know, like, silliness and his attitude towards life, like, fit in so well with the three of us anyway. Yeah. And, like, being a goofball and chup-chupping it up.
But, yeah, it was pretty much, like, funnest period of my life where I was actually, like, in a band and excited, wanted, like, everyone to know, like, everyone to listen, and, like, you know, was proud of it.
Getting back together was a kind of like a big, you know, emotional leap, and like physically being together and playing music again was so special to us. We wanted someone who was equally as enthusiastic, but not coming from that history of playing with us, we were like, how's that going to happen? Yeah, how is someone going to care so much about the band and want it to work and be hanging out with us and have that, like, you know, attitude of like brothers and sisters? And he was just that stoked and like, all about it, super wanted to play, cracked the whip in practice.
Whipcracker, 2000.
Seriously, no one would crack the whip like he did, and we have trouble getting things done almost without him doing that.
A lot of jib-jabbing.
Yeah, so much jib-jabbing.
And Dominic being like, you know, like a fun person, like, and all he wanted to do was like play music, you know, like, that's pretty much like, you know, the main thing that he wanted to do.
And we started going to meetings together, and I didn't want to talk and stuff, but he'd talk. He was involved, and I, you know, I thought about it, and I started seeing a therapist in the city, and I would go to meetings with Dominic. And I remember this one meeting, after the meeting, it was late at night, and we were all smoking in the back, and we got on the subject of his sobriety, and I remember saying to him something, and he said, "This is my last chance." He's like, "This is my last chance to do this." Because I remember I said, "You should do this, you should do that." He's like, "I can't do any of this stuff. I can only do this. This is my last chance to do this." And I said, "It's not your last chance. What are you talking about? If you fall, just get back up." And he's like, "No." He's like, "If I fail at this, I'm not going to get another chance."
And inevitably, it just kind of like came up. It's just like, "Dude, like I haven't seen you since any of this happened. Just like, what happened?" And he kind of told me. And then there was a certain point towards the end of it where he was like, "Can I tell you something that you can't tell anybody else?" And I was like, "Why? What is it?" And he was like, "I relapsed yesterday." And it was he said it was the first time that he had relapsed, and that I
was this
with OxyContin
on his birthday.
No, this was before that.
And Jim had been telling me, you know, he was so excited, like, the old Dominic's back, he's really funny, we're gonna get him back into shorts again, he's doing really great, and like, it's so exciting, you're gonna see Dominic again, it's just gonna be like it was before. And I was so excited for that, and when I saw him, he really wasn't the same. And he was really quiet and not like telling jokes or being like outgoing like I kind of expected him to be.
That he had done it once just the night before to just like, I don't know, he just wanted to see what it felt like. And I was like, "Well, how was it?" And he was like, "It wasn't that great."
He enough. Never, that's
the and whole I, and thing I was, about. And I was like, "So don't do it again, and I won't need to make this an issue." And so he never told me about it again, at least. But yeah, that was, I felt really guilty about that when I found out that he died.
You shouldn't, man.
I know.
It's tricky. You really shouldn't, dude.
It's tricky, though.
You know, we're like, "Oh, we could go on tour, like, you know, once we get the CD all done professionally, you know, like, bunch of good things were happening." But he was also, you know, having this drug, like, suffocate him and, like, destroy him and kind of, like, take him away.
Oh, he told
like, admitted
us.
To yeah, us he admitted. He, like, wanted to party for his birthday and stuff, and, like, he had some, like, extra birthday money or something, yeah. And he, like, was, like, kind of admitted that he relapsed, and that was, like, the first time that he had or something. And
yeah,
he
that's kinda, right.
Like, okay, like, all right. That you can't miss band practice and like keep with our, you know, gotta keep with our plans and stuff. It was like our first dealings with it, I guess.
Yeah.
Heroin and oxy, those drugs, like, doesn't matter who you are, you could be like the toughest person in the world, you know. And when those drugs like make you feel a certain way, it's like so hard to get them out, you know, like it doesn't matter who you are. Where it's like once you do those drugs, they just like, yeah, they like take over your life and like it'll like take out important things and be like, "Well, it's not that important anymore because I'm here," you know.
Yeah, I think the last time we had band practice was, I just think it was just one sad time that we were here and Dom just disappeared in the middle of band practice for a long time, and he came back and, you know, his eyes were rolling around. And
yeah, we were on the deck at like the yeah. table, and we were sitting and we were planning out like the next couple months and what we were going to do. Like we were trying to book a show at the Phoenix, and we were writing down like different shows and stuff to contact, and Dom like wanted to keep track of it all, and he had a notebook and like a pen, and he was like, he had come back from being, and then he was just like rolling his eyes back in his head and like trying to focus and like write down what we were saying.
He was trying really hard to like be able to talk, but it like wasn't making yeah. too much sense.
And it was like, I was having like a serious anxiety attack. I was like, "What's going on? This is so awkward. Like, yeah. I don't really know what to do." And then the
four of us. It was really heavy.
Of course, you know, I knew immediately. And he couldn't keep it together. He was wavering, and his eyes were rolling back in the back of his head, and he's like, "Sorry, I gotta go in the house." And he ran into the house. And Alexis and Nico both turned to me, and they said, "What's going on?" And I, you know, I was like, "He's fucking high. He's super high." And they didn't know what to do.
It was hard because we decided, you know, Eden came back and talked to him, and because, you know, Eden, yeah. Eden knew Dominic for a very long time and closer than Alexis and I did.
I went into his room and I shut the door and I asked if he was okay. He's like, yeah, I'm okay. And I was like, I love you a lot. I mean, I just said that, you know, I want to preface it with that. And I was like, but you're really high right now. And he's like, yeah, I'm high. And I was like, you know, and I forget what the whole conversation was.
We just decided to, for whatever reason, just it felt like it was the right thing to do at that time, you know. We just ended the band practice and we're like, you know what, man, like, you get, like, today you have to just,
yeah,
you gotta, we have to, like, go and do our own thing tonight and we can't have band practice right now. And it was really hard and he, like, really didn't want us to do it.
Yeah, it was super brutal. Like, we got up from the table and me and you went down way past to almost this, like, down the driveway, and you brought your guitar, and we were just talking about the Red Hot Chili Peppers and John Frusciante, and Eden was up here, like, talking to Dom about everything, what was going on.
But, yeah, I talked for a little while, and he wasn't even there. And it was sad. And I told him, you know, the conversation was, we're gonna leave. And obviously, you know, you're an addict and you're using again. And like, so what are you going to do about this? And he said, I'm not going to use anymore. I'm going to be done. I'm done. And I said, okay, well, why don't you give me the rest of your stash? Or we can flush down the toilet together right now. And he said, he thought for a second. He's like, no, I'm not going to do that. And I said, think about what you really want to do. Like, think about what you really want to do. You can stop this right now if you just do this with me. It'll be gone and you don't ever have to use again.
And I remember, I don't know how much I knew before. I think I knew to an extent. And I remember learning kind of later in the game, because I think, well,
did I tell you?
I think Jim told me, but you revealed that Jim hadn't told me earlier because he knew. Jim had said he, like, knew it would break my heart. Because I'm that kind of person. I don't, you know, like, obviously my relationship with Dominic was one of us both being, like, really innocent together. And, like, even with all that other stuff that happened, like, that was how I saw him. So this transformation I had no idea of.
Probably be good for you to just kind of say who you are and how you knew Dominic and go from there.
Okay. My name is Heather and I've worked with Dominic in the school program, so I wasn't his primary counselor, but we hung out a lot. And how I knew him? Well, I could say that I knew him from his episode down here in Newport Beach, getting sober. But I feel like I've known him for ever.
I remember, you know, I wasn't interested in meeting new people or doing anything ever, really, even if I wasn't just about to leave. And then one night, I see this kid, you know, show up, and I see him kind of glaring at me, like, kind of throughout, like, the first half hour he was there, and then eventually he just, like, comes up to me just full of energy, full of life, and just asks what I'm listening to, and I tell him, explain, you know, whatever, and I'm like, oh, fuck, like, really hope this kid doesn't try to latch on to me or whatever. And he really did. He came on strong, like, the first few days. And I wasn't really into it. I wasn't having it.
There was, like, one night where two of my other roommates and Dominic, we had, like, a big, huge pillow fight in the house. And we got in trouble for having a pillow fight, took the cushions off the couches, and beat the shit out of each other with the things. That's, like, one of my favorite memories. And then Dominic and tried to put a hole in the wall for the pillow, and we got in trouble for putting a hole in the wall with Jennifer Triss.
I forgot about this, but at first he would also be like, fuck, I'm sorry, I'm probably being really annoying right now. But then he would keep going. But then he would just intersperse that with, oh man, I'm sorry, I'm getting on your nerves, should I leave you alone? And I'm not going to say, like, yeah, leave me the fuck alone, you know. Like, no, you're cool. And he just starts to wear on you, and then you just fall in love with him. And he was unlike anybody at the center. He was unlike anybody I'd ever met.
One of the first things I said to him is he feels great. Like, there's a greatness about him.
Yeah.
And that it just felt like the whole world should know him. Like, why are you just sitting here in Newport Beach? I just felt like he's one of those, you know, like when somebody comes along, because there's a lot of wonderful people out there, but he was just so brilliant, you know, just those people who stand out and you know it right away. And they do, people envy him and whatever, and people are drawn to them. He just had that about him.
First time he played his music for me was in the computer lab, and I was just really, like, jealous. I listened to it on headphones, he had it on his iPod, and I was really just amazed.
I love jamming with him, even though he, like, really intimidated me. So it'd be like, yeah, I really want to jam with you, but I'm terrible compared to you, so, you know, let's just make it quick so I don't sit there and feel nervous the entire time. But it was just great playing with him. I go back and I like write new songs, and you know, just love doing it.
I didn't think this little kid, like, you know, I thought he was a goofball for a long time, and I didn't think he had it in him, but I knew he was, you know, way better than I was, and I wanted to play with him.
So I got reconnected with Dominic. I was living in Long Beach, and something just happened coincidentally, and I didn't know that he was down kind of in the area, in the Newport area. But when I put this dorky picture up of me and my dog, and it's just a dorky picture, but I really liked it. And Dominic, who I hadn't spoken to in a really long time, he commented and said something like, that's a good woman. And like... It just, like all of a sudden I was like, holy cow, like, Dominic, like, I miss Dominic so much just for things like what he just said.
Yeah, he always joked around about making fun of people. Not making fun of them, but just making people laugh in the house.
Sometimes making fun of people.
Yeah.
But that's okay.
Yep. It was just still funny.
Yeah.
You know, somebody said earlier, like, Dominic, would make fun. Well, he didn't really make fun of people. Like, yeah, we made fun of people. He was really good at it, you know. And it wasn't mean spirited. It, you know, sometimes may have been, but.
Oh my gosh, you're nearby me. Like, that's awesome. So, immediately I was like, let's hang out. Like. And he's like, oh, you don't have to drive to come see. I was like, no, like, you don't, like, this would be so much fun. Like, I'd love to see you. And I remember, like, talking it up, like, trying to explain to my boyfriend, like, no, there's this guy, and I'm so excited to see him again.
Gosh, there's so many stories about him. Okay, so when he won, okay, Student of the Week is this thing in Teach, in the school program, where somebody gets, you know, the highlight and the spotlight for that week. For whatever reason, and I wanted to make it not really about accomplishments, but just about who they are, so everybody, you know, would be able to get it. And it was his week, and we had been doing this tradition forever, okay? And what happens is everybody goes around and says something about you. And Dominic, he sat there and he was like so receptive and he listened to everything. But then he shunned a couple of the compliments, you know, like, oh, you know. And, but then when it was finished, you know, everybody goes, hold on. And he went around and said something about everybody else.
Which had never happened. The recipient never said nice things about the people complimenting him. Yeah.
And he was just like, oh, well, yeah, isn't it my turn now? And I just thought, it figures. Dominic, out of all these years that I've been doing that, he's the first one to do that, you know?
And he made it so everyone would go around and talk about the person. The person that was it and say nice things. And it meant a lot to me because I was the first person that was there and we all said really nice things about me. And I was having a really bad day and that wouldn't have happened unless Dominic was there. And I don't know, I just kind of think that he was one of those people that could like sense when he was very intuitive of people's feelings.
He was like, gung-ho, let's do this thing. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's time. I'm going to, you know, and I'm going to be the best ever at this kind of thing. But then he'd get down. He would, yes, he'd go up and down. And he wore it on his sleeve. I know he didn't like people necessarily to see the down, so he'd try to, but it was so obvious that he couldn't really cover it up, you know, and he'd come with his cut-off shorts, and he looked just like Huck Finn, you know, and I never quite knew which mood he would be in that day, you know, but he always, regardless of what mood he was in, he was amazing about sensing other people and where they were at, and he would like show up for them, even if he was feeling like empty.
And I think on the flip side of what you said, like because of what I knew happened, I didn't know if it would be the same Dominic. And I kind of, I guess, like there were little things that it was Dominic again. And it was just so wonderful. He was still Dominic, you know, like he told me everything. He was really open with me. We walked and I didn't ask him a thing. I didn't, you know, but he just wanted to tell me and he told me in a way that sounded like he was really, really working on it and focused. And it was, you know, he wanted things to get better.
When it all got laid out for me, it was on Christmas of 2010, I was living in Costa Mesa, about 8 minutes away from where Dom was at Sober Living by the Sea. And we had hung out several times, got a little bucks, and on Christmas we had plans. He was gonna get picked up by a friend and taken to some nice dinner or something like that. Fell through, couldn't get picked up.
The next weekend I went to see him again because it was just so, so good to see him. And there was, you know, there was both sides of it, but Dominic was still there and mm-hmm. still Dominic.
And I heard the whole story about everything, about, you know, the first time and then how he was clean during the recording process, how and when he relapsed and how that affected him, how serious it got, like the fact that he had to start stealing and you know, driving to Santa Cruz like every week because that's where he could score the heroin that he liked, you know, the most, or that was the most cost effective, or whatever the reason that brought him to Santa Cruz. But making that commute.
One joke was we were on a swing set, because we walked to a swing set and went on the swings. That sounded really nice. which again is back to like days of innocence. So it's, you know, I just loved. And he was talking about like sitches and how there wasn't a lot of Sitch Town Central going on. And so the swings, because we're adults, the swing set was shaking and reverberating with every swing. And I was like, oh, this is kind of awkward. And Dom was like, these days I'll take what I can get. So I remember, because, and after I saw Dominic, I remember there was a recent Santa Rosa trip after that, and it was like in a coffee shop, and I was telling everybody, I saw Dominic, he said the funniest things, this is everything that happened, and I was just like, and everybody was so jealous that I'd seen Dominic, they're like, oh, I love Dominic, like, that sounds so funny.
Right then, he told me, right now, I'm over the physical addiction, but I don't think that I will ever get over the mental addiction, and that's what's troubling, because once you get the idea in your head that, you know, once that mental addiction comes to the forefront and takes you over, like, it doesn't matter if you're physically addicted anymore, because
once you decide that that's what you want to do, then, you know, you're right back in it. And he was aware of that.
You know, it was like, oh my gosh, I have this back. And, you know, I was set. I was like, every weekend I'm coming, like, whether he wants to or not. Like, I'm coming visiting Dominic. So it was definitely, the timing was really, really difficult. Because, again, I had it all in my head. Like, seriously, I'd planned, like, oh, Dominic would like this. Maybe, like, we'll go see him. Oh, we'll pick Dominic up, bring him all the way back. Max will make Thai food. We'll all have fun. But, like, in retrospect, I'm just so, so grateful. Because, again, just like everybody else, I totally lost touch. You know, it's easy to lose touch. So I'm just so grateful to have had that time with him and to, like, get to see Dominic and know that through everything else, he was still very much Dominic.
I mean, he seemed, you know, so, so confident to, I think, everybody else, and so confident, so outgoing, and, you know, to everybody else. But, you know, he would talk to me like, you know, he hates the way he looks, or, you know, he doesn't want to be around anybody. And to me, I remember he said to me one time, like, in the beginning of our relationship, just like, man, I'm so depressed or whatever. And I just said, you're the most cheerful fucking depressed person I've ever met in my life. Because it didn't add up until you really, really knew him.
He never alluded to wanting to try again, but I could always tell that he, like, could never ever get over the mental addiction. That's what eventually killed him, when he decided, he made the same decision that fucked with him, you know, around his birthday, when he relapsed late July or early August, saying, I'm gonna do it one more time, but you can't do it one more time. You know, you do it one more time and you're right back in the thick of it.
The last day actually that I saw him was actually on that Friday, and he hung out the whole morning with me. He was, like, right under my wing, and he was very jovial and happy. I have an intuition of why he was jovial and happy. But he was talking to me about his old girlfriend, and so we had a real conversation for a moment, you know, in the morning there. He was the first one I saw when I came, and so we're out on the patio. And then we're talking about Valentine's Day, and that's when I called him, you know, he's just such a little lover, right? Because of what he was talking about. He goes, oh, I'm a big lover, you know? And he was so vibrant, because I think he had a sense of relief already, because he, you know, maybe had a plan.
And then I think I heard something at the center, like, oh, Dominic's gone or whatever. Dominic left, you know, not gone, but he skipped town with this girl. But he didn't tell me about it before he left. I don't know, maybe he thought I could convince him otherwise, and he didn't want that to happen. But he didn't tell me about it before he left. But, I mean, honestly, I wasn't worried. You know, we kept in contact, like, and it was always, you know, I'm coming back Monday, I guess it was. I'm coming back Monday. And I was like, okay, Dom will be back Monday. We'll go to detox for a couple days, then I'll be back. It'll be back to normal. Hopefully they'll kick this girl or whatever out of the program, so I'll be back to Brandon and Dominic again.
But I was really affected by Dom. And I could try to tell you why, but I just was, you know? Because he just, he's one of those who was in there, you know? I just loved him.
I got a good comeback.
No, you can't have it. I got that deep brown sugar blues.
It was just so shocking, and it felt so unfair because I had just seen him and he was trying so hard. And I think, you know, not that it would have been better, but I think I could have handled it if, like, the news was it's been really bad and Dominic relapsed and we're really sad, you know, but it just felt so, just so unfair that he was trying so hard and he relapsed and it killed him.
I remember when I found out, yeah, I was actually supposed to be on duty that weekend. I was the staff who was supposed to be on duty. And I remember my heart just sunk because I thought if I was on duty and I could have talked to him, like I started to think these things, right? He might have listened to me or, you know. And I thought, well, obviously I was taken off duty, so I wasn't supposed to, you know. So you know how you walk yourself through those conversations.
They took me back and they led me to this back room. And everybody else was already standing in there. And I saw Johnny O. I don't think, you know, no, I think I walked in and people were already crying and they'd told everybody already. And I just looked around and I knew, you know. And Heather had been acting weird all morning. And so I, you know, kind of had that feeling something was up, and then I walked into that room and, you know, I looked around and I knew. And so I just left and I walked down to the pier I just sat at the pier for a few hours. And then it's just kind of a blur, like, afterwards, like, for the next couple weeks.
Every time it just felt like it had been such a long time, and I just felt so removed from everything, and it was just so hard to see everybody again, like 4 years later since I had seen them, 5 years later, and like see them all at Dominic's funeral, and like, you know, at the viewing and stuff like that. I saw people I haven't seen in like 5 years, and it was just, it was so surreal to see everyone like grown up and like dealing with this situation together. And I felt like it was like our whole family kind of came together and was like dealing with this tragedy, like as a group, which is how it should be.
He went into detail about the withdrawals, you know, what it did to his family. He told me he was so brutally honest. And then the next time I've heard that story twice. I heard it from Dominic, and then I heard it from Jim at the funeral. Up until the part where he decided that he was going to split with that chick and go to Hollywood. And that's what destroyed me at the funeral, is just listening to his story, because it was seriously, it felt like verbatim from Dom. Yeah. It was just, you know, from a different point of view, but it was the exact same story. And it was just like, I don't know, that was a really powerful thing.
You know, when people despair is when all they look out and all they can see are just bad things, worse things, and even worse things. And it's, and that's, I think that's a big part of like sort of the spiral of addiction, because it's like you look out at your future and all you can see are terrible things. And so it's like, what is the point of even fighting this thing then? You know what I mean? You know that it's going to be very difficult, physically painful, emotionally like gut-wrenching, and you're gonna have to face all these like demons and stuff, and it's just gonna be like the most difficult thing you'll ever do. But you can't expect someone to do something that difficult unless they see some good at the end of it, you know? I mean, it's like, how do you expect someone to climb up a mountain unless you convince them that there's something worthwhile at the top of it? And if there was anything that I wish I could have, like, conveyed to him, it would have been to just how, like, the fact that, like, that he was worth saving. And you know, I mean, he was just a great guy, and I just wish that I could have told him that.
Like, I'm so glad that I got to know him in the short time that I did. Because I guess because I got so much out of it, you know. He's just this amazing person, and I know I'll never get the chance to meet anybody like that ever again. And I'm grateful, mostly. There's still those times where it's like, you know, there's still that, like, fuck, I wish he was here right now. But, you know, mostly it's gratitude.
You know, when I think back of Dominic, I think of, you know, this incredibly unique person, you know, who's, you know, I didn't know anyone else like him, but he could still, you know, relate to everyone, which is, you know, for someone so different, you know, he's still, I don't know how to put it, but he, you know, he just, I don't know, made you feel special, I suppose. And he just really knew how to, he just, like, understood me, you know, so it was, I don't know, it was just, like, this amazing person who, you know, seemed to care about me so much, which was, you know, that was, I don't know, made me feel good about myself, I suppose.
Dominic called me every day and asked me if I want to go to a meeting every day. And every day I said, no, I don't want to go to a meeting. I don't want to go. Like, I need to just get over this right now. But, you know, he still called me every day. I mean, which is pretty fucking amazing, you know? Dominic, I don't think, it seemed like he'd never taken such initiative in his life to, like, do something like that. And, you know, and he did it to save mine. And, you know, and so I owe, like, a big, you know, the fact that, you know, that I'm still here and that my life was saved, like, I wouldn't have gone myself, you know?
shovel started to dig 6 feet was all I got. And I checked a couple of times, and hell still hot. I picked up my shovel, started to dig 6 feet was all I got. And I checked a couple of times, and hell still hot. 'Cause you and me, we have this thing going on. You tell the town they like to talk about. Talk about